Now for the remaining examples, we're going to use a plist and a JSON file that both represent a maze like the one you've seen in the Maze app. Let's start by peeking at the plist. At the top level, it contains a count for the number of rows, the number of columns, and some cell data. The cell data is an array, and if we drop down, we can see that it contains arrays as well. And if we click one of the arrays, it contains more arrays. Wow. And if we click one of the arrays, then we see that we have these four Boolean values. And this repeats for every single one of the innermost arrays. Now, that was pretty ugly to look at, and it may seem complicated, but what it's really modeling is a 2D grid. Each of the innermost arrays describes a grid cell, like the one seen here. And it tells us if the grid cell contains a wall or a path on the top, the right, the bottom, or the left of the cell. Now let's take a look at this cell that we've marked in blue. The first value in the array is true, or yes. These map pretty directly, so that means that there should be a wall on the top. The next value is also true, so that means there should also be a wall on the right. For the next item, we have a no, or a false. So there's no wall, or we'd say that there's a path on the bottom of this cell. And the same goes for the left. Now, if you think back to the Maze app, these top, right, bottom, and left represents the walls and the paths. And you can see that more clearly here. That cell that we were just looking at, it's the cell in the top right-hand corner. And we can see that the top and right are true, so we have a wall on the top and the right, but the bottom and the left are false, so there's a path here. Now if we go back to the plist file, we'll see that the number of arrays here matches the number of rows. So we have five rows, and then we have one, two, three, four, five arrays. And the number of arrays within a row, one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, matches the number of columns. So this plist describes a 5x7 maze. Now the JSON file contains the exact same data, but it's formatted a little bit differently. And as we're looking at it here, it's kind of hard to read. It's not very pretty. Now, when you're faced with JSON like this, I'd recommend copy and pasting it into an online JSON tool that prettifies it. And prettify, or prettify, is not a real word. I mean to say that it formats the JSON so it's much easier to read. So we'll go ahead and copy this. And then this is jsonprettyprint.com. And we'll paste it in. And then we'll run. And that's much better. So again, if you have some really complex JSON that's kind of mangled and you want to spread it out and make it pretty and easier to read, I'd recommend using a tool like this. So now that we have a rough idea of what this data looks like and it represents, what can we do with it? So let's think about how we would model this in code. Here's a struct that represents one of the cells that we saw. So it's got four Boolean values, true and false values representing whether there's a wall or a path for the top, right, bottom, and left. And as we saw a second ago, based on the true and false values in each array for each grid cell, we could determine whether there's a wall or a path. So these are a couple examples that give us an idea of what the grid cell might look like. So when everything is true, we have walls on the top, the left, the right, and the bottom. When this last bool value is false, and that represents the left, then the left side has a path while everything else has a wall. And then if everything is false, then we have a path that goes to the top, the left, the right, and the bottom. So let's imagine that we have this simplified version of the cell data. It only has two rows and two columns. And if we were to go through each grid cell, then we would result in a representation that's something like this.